manuscript tradition of the Gospel of Mark. Gospel of Mark, I'm going to ask him for the convenience sake again, because he wants us to somehow don't be ad hominem attached to him. Are you, from your knowledge, familiar with the different types of the endings of the Gospel of Mark within the manuscript tradition?
What is the relevance? My problem with this is if it was...
My question is not about how relevant it is. My question is, are you even familiar with it?
I don't want to go off course.
Do you know? Do you have knowledge?
Stick to the point.
Okay.
No.
Just be honest. Do you know?
It's irrelevant. You can ask me many questions, sub-line questions.
Okay.
I'm talking about...
I know that you don't know.
Going to the core. Well, it's relevant.
I know that you don't know.
It's irrelevant.
Okay, let me tell you that.
I'm just saying it's irrelevant.
Okay.
I don't want to discuss the endpoints.
Here.
I don't want to discuss the endpoints of Mark.
In Codex Sinaiticus and Washingtonians, excuse me, Codex Sinaiticus, listen carefully. In Codex Sinaiticus, how does it end? How does the Gospel of Mark end in Codex Sinaiticus? The earliest complete, not complete, near complete, manuscript.
It does not.
How does it end?
It does not go away from the core.
How does it end? Do you even know?
It's not relevant to the
do
point.
Do you know?
It's not relevant to the point.
So basically the answer is, yes, I do know, or I don't know.
Not relevant.
Which one?
Relevant.
You are unwilling to admit anything. Do you know why?
Because it's a relevant
because
topic.
You
it's
know relevant. Very well you are now being exposed to the whole world of your ignorance, and you come here to what? Teach about your Bible.
It's irrelevant.
So let me ask you again.
It's irrelevant to the topic.
Okay.
Irrelevant to the topic.
How many manuscripts supports a very long ending of the Gospel of Mark? How many manuscripts supports that?
I don't see the point of your argument.
I'm asking you a question. I'm not asking you whether it's relevant or not.
Relevant to the topic. Look, I don't want to discuss it.
Your statement, is it relevant, is irrelevant to me. So now tell me, how many manuscripts have no ending? How many manuscripts have a long ending? Go ahead, answer. Whatever. When you say it's irrelevant, that's irrelevant to me.
My topic. My
excuse me.
Are
you man enough?
I'm talking now.
With knowledge of the manuscripts, are you knowledgeable enough to talk about the manuscripts? Excuse me.
Let me. No. You've had your point.
Do you see?
You said you've had your point.
How can you
talking.
Have a
now
meaningful conversation with someone?
I'm going to have my point.
Who knows very well
to
when the evidence is presented. Look, manuscript evidence.
One way.
When the evidence is presented, they run away like chicken.
It's not the point.
It's not evidence. I'm sorry.
It's not evidence. It's
okay.
Not, it's not.
Do you know what I'm talking about? What? I'm talking about how. Listen. You're ignored.
Good.
I'm talking about
how
the manuscript tradition shows the corruption that has occurred in the text of the biblical scripture. Throughout centuries, there have been corruptions.
Of course there were.
Additions.
A flood of corruption.
Yes. Can you tell him that? Can you tell him that? Yes, and that's exactly what I was showing from manuscripts. Like this example here, John 7:53 to 8:11, right? Story about the adulterous woman. Now, one second. I will go to the details. If you bear with me, I'll get details with you. So the earliest manuscript, Papyri 66. Remember this gentleman was talking about papyrus? Papyri 66 does not have this story, which is the earliest of your manuscripts. Now, you have a lot of explanation to do now. Why is your earliest manuscripts not have that story and later manuscript have that story? Because you should have the earliest manuscripts.
Your Quran is not complete.
We're talking about the Bible. Why is it the earliest manuscripts of your particular story doesn't have it in the papyri?
Yeah.
For example.
Think about one thing.
One thing about 1 John.
Before the story
on.
Was written, was evident, it must have been told for many times.
No, it doesn't work like that. When we have a statement like, in the heavens, there are the three. The what? Who are the three in the heaven? Because that's why they say in 1 John 5:7 it proves Trinity. This was nowhere to be found prior to the Middle Ages. Manuscripts.
Fourth century.
Manuscripts Before the 15th century, they don't have that passage. We know
it's not in the Greek.
In the Greek, yeah, it's because it's the Greek test, New got Testament to Quran. In what?
We've got evidence of it.
Yeah. But it's not. But we are talking about Greek. It was written in Greek. So why do we have only Codex Montfortianus, early 16th century? A variant 88 in the 16th century Han added to the 14th century Codex Regius of Naples.
Yeah, I think.
No. It is only found in 8 very late Greek manuscripts.
Right. This is my response.
So, before you respond, is it found in Codex Sinaiticus?
Codex Sinaiticus has never been tested. It was supposed to be age tested, and it's when they were supposed to age test it, for some strange reason,
what is the earliest gospel or account? Sorry, 1 John. The scripture of 1 John, the earliest manuscript that you have for it.
I don't know it per se.
Right.
I don't know it so, per se.
Scholars,
but it's fine for me to say that, but...
Is this a forgery in the Middle Ages?
Not from the Middle Ages, because there's evidence of it from before.
No, that's what the scholars say. Well, this is a forgery introduced in the Middle Ages, 15th, 16th century, in the Greek New Testament texts, where this was introduced to support the doctrine of Trinity. What do you have to say for that? You need to provide some explanation.
We have the Trinity without the need of that verse. we have Trinity, which has been explained to you many times, Mansur.
Firstly, you're making claims.
The Trinity has been explained to you guys.
I think you're lying. I think you're lying.
I don't care.
I've watched the video. One moment.
No, I haven't finished my sentence.
Is Trinity, did believe that the three are one or three are two?
There's no such word called Trinity.
Exactly. So now let me ask you now.
We're talking about concept.
Let me ask you.
We're talking about the concept.
The concept of the Trinity is the three are one or three are four. What's the concept?
Well, you know what it is.
No, I'm asking you.
I know.
What is the concept?
Three in one.
Right. Is there any passages in the entire Bible where the concept is found that the three are one? In a clear way, in an unambiguous way, in a way that doesn't need an explanation. You claimed the Trinity is found in the Bible. We have a gentleman here who says, no, that's not true.
Of course it does.
Which book?
We appreciate you don't agree with
the Godhead,
but he's not a Christian.
So,
he's not a Christian. So
which book?
I beg your pardon?
You're not a Christian.
I beg your pardon?
You got it right.
I beg your pardon?
You're not a Christian.
You're not a Christian. Show me. I have 81 books. Let's bust him now.
Yes.
You know how long I want to bust you? I want to bust you.
Bring your books up.
I'm going to bust you.
Now, show me from the 81 books, which book, which chapter, which verse says the three are one?
And you say, because you call me not a Christian, because you say I'm not a Christian,
we have
to go to the original 1611.
Go ahead.
We have the 81 book.
Through the Bible.
Go ahead.
It's
your chance to prove you're a Bible-believing Christian. Show us where Trinity is found there.
You caused that.
Not in the way you're saying.
Show us where it's found.
You can't find it.
So let's define it.
What we can talk about, God
is. Is Trinity a concept where three are one?
No such thing. No such thing.
Is Trinity.
Wait.
Is Trinity a concept where the Father, the Son, and the Holy Spirit are one?
Yeah, we can find a way of
Excuse me.
Which text
supports this concept?
No. It doesn't work that way.
Have you got internet?
You have been told many times
is Yahweh God in the only in your Bible?
Yes.
Does it say anywhere? Does it state anywhere that Yahweh is God?
No. In that case, yes, it does.
It does. Do I need to somehow twist and turn to understand that? Or it's quite obvious. It says you should have no other gods besides
me.
Before you explain.
Certain things are very black and white, I would agree.
What things?
Certain things in Bible, like Yahweh.
Important things?
And important things.
Is important things black and white?
Let me finish. Not all important things are black and white. Some things
what about God? How many years? What about whether it's true to you or not? Is that explained?
Some things have to be worked out.
Wait. Whether God is 1, 2, 3, 50 million, or 3 in 1, or 2 in 20, Is that explained clearly?
Like salvation.
Excuse me, I'm asking you a specific question. About God, whether it's 1, 2, 20, 1 million, 360 million, 5 in 20, 3 in 1, 2 in 4, is that explained clearly?
So we can't see which one's looking at. It looks clear, but it's not. Look through here.
They reach 8. I can prove
it. Let me explain what I mean. Let me explain what I mean.
I mean, a social media, a chat board, me and a talk, wicked things, and we speak heresy. The guy we read from the book.
Mansur,
no, let's talk about heresy, man, sir. Heresy is when you talk something when you're written in a book. He said, do not add or take away.
I'll tell you 1 second.
Do not add or take away. These men had what they want to have and take away what they want to take. Hating people. What the Bible say about hating?
I don't hate anyone.
You hate me?
Of course I don't.
You just hate me?
No, I don't.
Didn't you just call me and say I'm not Christian? So what am I?
What do you call
me?
That's my view.
You said I'm not a Christian.
That's my view.
You're judging me, right?
That's my view.
So I can judge you. You're a pagan.
That's my view. You can say what you like.
Don't have to talk with him. Run him.
Right.
That's my fight.
So now, you claim that you have been talking about Trinity. Now, is the concept of Trinity found? You said no. You just said no. It's not clear.
Let me ask you.
Why did God not make clear in your scripture whether it's 1 or 20?
There are many scriptures.
No, why did you not clear?
Let me
make clear.
Let me
about him.
Let me respond, yeah? You're going to give me the chance to respond without interrupting. So I'll get a full sentence out of it. So there are many scriptures in the Bible which are not explicitly explained in a very quick verse that you would like. And it is a case of reading through the scriptures to get the understanding. And the reason why God did that is because he wanted people to truly search for his word, to really search for him. And that is the way he has done that, and he's made a very demonstrative rider through scripture on many, many accounts about having to understand through the storyline, to understand how these prophecies and predictions and foreshadowing and all these other kind of concepts are not easy to just determine by a single verse. It is through good study is the way that you can come to the conclusion. It is through good study of scripture you come to the conclusion that Father is God, Jesus is God, Spirit is God, and they are in some way one. They work together, they're always together, and that is our understanding, and that's how we draw the conclusion.
Excuse me, please, okay?
That's how we, and the Trinity is to try and define that concept. That's all it is.
Right.
Did that make sense to you? You understand what I'm
saying? I'll tell you why it doesn't make sense. Brother, please, okay?
It's fine, you're gonna nod your head.
It doesn't make sense, I'll tell you why. In the book of Isaiah, we have passages like this. Before me, there is no God form. After me, there is no God form. I alone am God and there is none else. When we read scriptures like this, what do we understand God is trying to say? There was some God before him, along with him, besides him. Or he is the one and only God. And there is none else besides him.
Again, this money
has what do you understand? What do you understand when God says there's no one before me?
Let me explain.
Does that mean there's someone before him?
Isaiah 44. So we've got Isaiah 44 verse 6 and 24. Yeah. Same passage you're reading from. Yeah.
Okay.
Thus saith the Lord, the King of Israel. Mm-hmm. Yeah. So we know that's Yahweh.
No, don't explain. Read first.
I'm asking.
That's how it works with me. No, excuse me.
Yeah.
When you're going to present me a text, I don't want your explanation.
Okay.
You're going to tell me which text.
Okay. So
read only.
I'll read it. Thus saith the Lord, mm-hmm. the King of Israel, and his Redeemer, the Lord of hosts. From Isaiah 44, then, you were just speaking. Who is the King of Israel?
Read the old text. Read the text. Finish it.
It's from the same text.
Finish the sentence.
Two persons in that text.
Excuse me. Finish the sentence.
Would you accept that we've got two persons in that text?
You're asking me to
I'm asking you a direct question.
And I am asking you to finish the whole verse.
You have two persons in that. If you're not going to accept it, say you're not going to accept it.
Why are you so difficult?
I'm
asking you simply to read the text in whole, completely.
Does anybody have a look at that? Even her.
No.
There, yeah?
Excuse me.
No,
excuse
I'm just going to ask the same
No, you're not going to. He's not going to.
No. Same method.
I'm asking you simply.
I'm asking you something.
Do you know what I'm asking you?
And the premise.
I'm asking you simply. I'm asking you.
Have a look.
Hashem, don't give me
the same.
listen, one discussion.
That's fine, just have a look at it. It's not going to hurt you to have a look at it.
Excuse me, listen.
What's the reference?
I'm simply asking him to read the full sentence. He's not doing that. Read the full verse and then ask me the question.
I don't need to read the full verse.
No, you have to, it's important. No, you have to read the full verse. Then I can't talk to you anymore. So now, let me ask you again. When God says, excuse me, when God says in Isaiah to you, and there is none else,
let me explain.
When there is none else, what does it mean?
It means that in terms of a true God, there is only one true God, that any other God is a false God and is not associated
with me.
Now,
who's me?
When that one true God exists,
who's me? When God says, before me, who's me?
Now, we are talking about, when we go through scripture,
how is that? It doesn't work like that.
It does. That's how the
when we have written. A passage which says, I alone am God and there's none else, before me, there was no God form. After me, there will be no God form. I'm going to ask you a serious question. Contemplate. In the English language, I, me, us, we, they don't mean the same thing. So who is I and who is me in this verse?
So what you have to do is you have to look at all the verses that talk about where God references himself, okay? To get a true understanding of that.
You can answer my question, right?
So yeah, I'm answering your question.
Okay, let's hear him.
It's not a single verse and then draw the conclusion that when he says I, therefore he only means the Father. Because there are clear scriptures where it talks about the plurality of God. It talks about the Son of God. It talks about how the Father recognizes his Son as God. It talks about scriptures, where many scriptures, where it talks about that Jesus is God. So there are many definitions. It talks about how Jesus is the first and the last. It talks about how God is of the same attributes to the Father is given to the Christ. And when you look at all these scriptures, you can see that this one Godhead as one doesn't mean one in the Islamic sense, that there's no partner, there's no association, but it's actually there is a Godhead where there is a triune divinity working in that Godhead. But it is one God, but there is a triune nature. And you can't get it from a verse the way you're asking. The only way you can do it is read from Genesis to Revelation properly, pulling all the scriptures that talk about God, his divinity and so forth. That's how you come to that conclusion.
Now answer the question. Who is I and who is me in this verse?
Did you not see what I'm saying?
Excuse me, I heard you waffling around.
No,
I'm asking you a direct question.
That is the basis of
a direct question. In the English language, which you are speaking with me right now, I is not same as we. Who is I and me in the verse that I quoted?
We know that in scripture the word one, which is used as
I'm not talking about one.
One.
I'm talking about I and me.
So there is a plurality of the oneness of God in scripture.
Do you know what I means?
You explain that to me. You explain that.
Firstly,
to me. Explain that to
firstly,
me.
I ask you again a direct question.
That's how you answer.
Who is I and me when God says, which you say God is claiming, I am God, before me there was no one else, after me there was no one else, I alone am God and there is none else. Who is this I and who is this me?
The Father, the Son and the Spirit.
If you look at the other Bible verses.
So when somebody says I, it means several people talking together.
Yeah. You look at other scriptures, you get the plurality.
Wait. When God says, let us make man in our image, does it say let me or let us? Who is us? I say it's only Jesus. Would that be correct?
No.
Why not?
When we look at scripture,
okay, wait. If I say this is only referring to the Jesus, when it says us, would I be correct?
Which is what you're not.
Would I be correct if I said this refers to Jesus only?
What I'm doing is I'm not picking out a verse.
I'm teaching you English if you didn't realize.
Yeah, but it's not very.
The difference between us and I.
But it's a misapplication of scripture.
Wait, English. No. Firstly, we have to teach and learn English.
No.
English is not my first language, but I know very well when somebody says, I alone am God and there's none else, it doesn't mean we are gods, many of us, together. Because it's using the very direct language of I.
It can be defined as I as being one God, which may have parts within that, but as a God is singular.
Okay.
So God is I in that sense.
Brother, please, please.
That's clear in scripture.
Please, brother, please.
That's
clear in scripture. Thank you. Now,
that's my point.
Does the Trinity as a Godhead speak? Or the Father speaks only? The Holy Spirit speaks only? Or Jesus, the Son of God, speaks only? Or do you have a fourth speaker called the Godhead?
They all speak.
One moment. I want you to tell me in directly. We know Father speaks to His Son. And the Son speaks to His Father in the New Testament.
That's right.
Yep. We have narrations like this. We have two speakers.
Yeah.
Maybe the Holy Spirit speaks. I don't know.
Yeah, it does.
Do you have any evidence from the scripture? Godhead also speaks as an agent, which comprises the three individuals together, and Godhead is the unity of the three that speaks also like the Father, like the Son, and like the Holy Spirit.
The problem is you're making a particular definition of the Godhead.
I am asking you, does the Godhead as an agent speak? Does the Godhead speak? Does the Godhead speak? The answer is yes or no.
In your definition.
Oh, I don't know.
But it's not an accurate definition. Valid. It's an valid point.
Do you accept? Godhead is a separate entity that speaks.
The Godhead is the three in one.
And who speaks when it says I?
Huh?
Who's speaking?
Who knows?
Do you know?
No, I don't.
You don't know. So now, when God says,
unless the scripture reveals it,
okay,
we don't know.
In your scripture, when it says I alone am God and there's none else, who's speaking?
Godhead.
So Godhead speaks.
It could be just the Father at the time. I don't know. We just don't know.
Hang on.
But the Bible, doesn't explicitly tell us.
Wait a moment.
It's not really. It doesn't really.
Is Godhead a separate conscious entity?
It's academic. You see.
Is the Godhead in your belief a separate conscious entity that speaks and listens?
Trying to make definitions of.
I'm asking you simply and directly. Is a Godhead in your Christian belief an entity that has consciousness and speaks and listens?
See, what you're trying to do, what you're
answer
trying to
my
do,
direct I'm question.
I'm going to ask you a question.
Directly, please.